Well, good morning and welcome in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Been one of those kind of mornings, so hopefully I can get my act together. But welcome to all of you, whether you're here in person or joining us online. It's great to have you either way. For those of you who are online, if you would please remember to say hello in the comment section. That way we know you're watching and we can do it. That's how we do attendance. Sign in, we know you're there. Otherwise, we don't know you're watching. So we appreciate that. The latest COVID-19 infection rate numbers for Wabash County are going in the right direction, so that's a good deal. Just don't go north. Michigan is spilling over a little, but we're holding on and we're doing good. Haven't heard any changes come out of the county health department office, so I'm presuming that their request for us to wear masks expires as it did, as they had originally announced on May 10th. So next Sunday should be the last Sunday that we'll be requiring masks. We will still encourage them, but we won't require them unless something changes. That's good. It's a new month, so we have a new Second Mile monthly giving emphasis for this month. It's Pine Creek Camp. We take that offering three times a year with a total goal for the year of $1,000. This month it's $300, so we appreciate your giving to that. This is also the month in which we help to prepare the meals, the fellowship community meals. Be on Tuesday, February 11th, and again on February. Where did that come from? May 11th and May 25th. Like I said, it's been an interesting morning. And your support in purchasing, preparing, and serving the meals is needed and appreciated. So you can contact the church office or contact Donna Siegert directly to see how you might be able to help. Also, just a reminder that both the men's and the women's Tuesday morning Bible studies are back meeting. They're both meeting here at the church, 7:30 on Tuesday mornings, if you'd like to be a part of that. Finally, once again, we have the bulletin insert. If you have a graduate anywhere in your family and you want us to include that in our celebration, then complete that form and get it into the church office by May 16th. And I have one other announcement. When people don't show up to be greeters when they're signed up to be, that oftentimes it's because something happens at the last minute and we don't know it, but sometimes the last minute is a good thing. And Simcoe's had their baby this morning. They're supposed to be visitors, but it looks like they called in the grandparents. You know, that's what happens on birthday. But Alice Simcoe, born this morning. I think LaDonna said about four. I let LaDonna do a terrible thing. She told me about this instead of writing it down for me. So I have had to run back to her several times to get things correct. Keep the Simcoe family in you. I presume mom is doing fine and all that sort of thing. So good deal. Who's got the other kids? Okay. That's what grandparents are for, right? All right. Well, we celebrate that. Drop them a card. Let them know you celebrate it too. A new life is always good. Any other announcements this morning? If not, then let us prepare our hearts for worship as we listen to the prelude. Thank you.
Good morning. It's good to be back here again today. Please stand if you are able and join me in the call to worship. God is the true vine.
And we are the branches.
Connected to God.
Connected to bear fruit.
Connected to God.
Or we wither away.
Connected to God.
Or useless.
We come to worship God, who is the true vine.
God, teach us how to remain connected so that we might bear good fruit.
Our opening hymn is Thine Be the Glory. The words will be on the screen. Please join me in the opening prayer. God of love, plant us in the soil of your grace. Nurture us with the strength of Christ, the vine of everlasting life. Enlighten us with the wisdom of your Spirit, which flows through us today and all days. Abide in us, that we may abide in you. And live in your love. In your holy name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. In our first scripture lesson, taken from the 8th chapter of Acts, Philip's mission to the outcasts of Israel continues as the Spirit sends him to the Ethiopian eunuch. An angel from the Lord spoke to Philip. At noon, take the road that leaves from Jerusalem to Gaza. This is a desert road. So he did. Meanwhile, an Ethiopian man was on his way home from Jerusalem, where he had come to worship. He was an eunuch and an official responsible for the entire treasury of Candace. Candace is the title given to the Ethiopian queen. He was reading the prophet Isaiah while sitting in his carriage. The Spirit told Philip, "Approach this carriage and stay with it." Running up to the carriage, Philip heard the man reading the prophet Isaiah. He asked, "Do you really understand what you are reading?" The man replied, "Without someone to guide me, how could I?" Then he invited Philip to climb up and sit with him. This was the passage of scripture he was reading. Like a sheep, he was led to the slaughter, and like a lamb before its shearer is silent, so he didn't open his mouth. In his humiliation, justice was taken away from him. Who can tell the story of his descendants, because his life was taken from the earth? The eunuch asked Philip, "Tell me, about whom does the prophet say this? Is he talking about himself or someone else?" Starting with that passage, Philip proclaimed the good news about Jesus to him. As they went down the road, they came to some water. The eunuch said, "Look, water. What would keep me from being baptized?" He ordered that the carriage halt. Both Philip and the eunuch went down to the water, where Philip baptized him. When they came up out of the water, the Lord's Spirit suddenly took Philip away. The eunuch never saw him again, but went on his way rejoicing. Philip found him in Azotus. He traveled through that area, preaching the good news in all the cities until he reached Caesarea. Please remain seated as we sing our hymn of preparation, "Take Our Bread." The words will be on the screen. Please stand as you are able for the reading of the gospel. In our gospel lesson taken from the 15th chapter of the Gospel of John, Jesus lays out the believer's relation to him as the Christ. "I am the true vine, and my Father is the vineyard keeper. He removes any of my branches that don't produce fruit, and he trims any branch that produces fruit so that it will produce even more. You are already trimmed because of the word I have spoken to you. Abide in me, and I will abide in you. A branch can't produce fruit by itself, but must remain in the vine. Likewise, you can't produce fruit unless you abide in me. I am the vine, You are the branches. If you abide in me and I in you, then you will produce much fruit. Without me, you can't do anything. If you don't abide in me, you will be like a branch that is thrown out and dries up. Those branches are gathered up, thrown into a fire, and burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask for whatever you want and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified when you produce much fruit, and in this way prove that you are my disciples. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated.
So far through this season of Easter, we've been introduced in a way through senses, or at least metaphorically, and how we connect with the risen Christ. Well, today it's time for a change in our metaphor, at least somewhat. What is consistent is that we're still living out, we're still embodying the resurrection. But we're moving away now from the specific senses that helped us access the risen Christ. For this fifth Sunday of Easter, we move to sustaining what we have seen and touched and heard by abiding in Christ. This 15th chapter of the Gospel of John, Jesus is on his way out. He's on his way to suffering, death, resurrection, and ascension. He's going away, apart from his disciples. He knew it, and he'd told them over and over. He had told them. Did they not get it? Did they just glaze over whenever he talked about that departure? Did they live each day of their new and exciting lives with the risen Christ there among them, thinking that it was always going to be like that? Probably. Do any of us spend our days wondering what life would be like without our closest ones in it? Well, sometimes on our saddest days. And if we try to talk to those we love about this impending departure, they don't want to hear it. They don't want to talk about it. I can just picture the disciples are there in the room with Jesus. They've just finished what will be their last meal together. And all the disciples have stuck their fingers in their ears and are singing, "La, la, 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 I can't hear you." Every time Jesus starts this Son of Man will be lifted up to die routine. But he knew it. Jesus knew it as surely as he knew at that point he was still breathing. And he faced it with the same confidence in which he had faced drawing that first breath as a newborn baby. With the same sense of presence that he had felt when he rose from the muddy waters of Jordan with a beaming yet trembling John the Baptist beside him. He faced it with the same sense of possibility and responsibility that brought a sigh out of him when he healed in the face of doubt, or the groan that came when he tossed out a demon that thought it was secure with its claws deep in some human's psyche. He knew what was next. And so he wanted to prepare them. Abide in me, Jesus said, as kind of an antidote to his absence. Abide in me. But wait. He's leaving, so he wants them to abide in him, to live in him. Now, Jesus didn't say, you should have lived in me, or you could have lived in me if you'd been paying attention. No, he's saying, there's still time. The clock hasn't run out yet. Abide. Get in there and abide. There's still hope. We're all still alive. But how? This is almost like when Jesus was talking to Nicodemus. You have to be born again. How am I supposed to crawl back in my mother's womb? How do we crawl into Jesus? As is often the case, Jesus is annoyingly short on details, even as he is rich in imagery. Vines and branches, fruit and gardeners. There's a secret here. Not a hidden code kind of thing, but it's an obvious puzzle that if we could just glimpse it, it would explode in our heads like a lightning bolt. You don't have to have a degree in ancient languages or theology or anything like that. Just you need to have an aha moment that unfolds the truth that has always been here. And it's in the metaphor. I like metaphors. And you know, Jesus could have, he could have just mentioned the whole vine thing and left it at that. I am the true vine. That's a pretty powerful statement. Not only for us, but especially for those first hearers. Because the image of the vine is woven all throughout the scriptures of Jesus' day, what we call the Old Testament. The prophets loved to talk about the vine. But for them, the vine was Israel. A vine uprooted from Egypt and planted in the promised land. A vine that was meant to bear fruit to feed many. But also a vine that withers when it neglects its source of strength. When it becomes disconnected. This sounds surprisingly what Jesus is saying here in his final discourse. Stay connected. Even when I'm physically gone, remember your source of strength and bear fruit. What changes now is that instead of a nation, the vine is God in a person. I am the true vine, said Jesus. Startling, no doubt. Maybe even offensive to a degree. How could one man replace a nation? But look again, because it's in the details. Jesus differentiates between the vine and the branches. I am the vine, Jesus says. You are the branches. He's bringing the source of our strength, closer to us. Instead of the people being uprooted and planted by God, and sometimes withering when they forget that, now the source of strength is right here. We're connected to it. We abide in it. We, the people of God, are still the ones who bear the fruit. That's how God decided it should work. God just moved a little closer because, well, we can use the help. A Apart from God, apart from our source of strength, the vine, we can do nothing. So we must stay close. In a vineyard, the best grapes are produced closest to the central vine. So we need to learn from that and stay close. But that doesn't mean that we don't need to be pruned. We wish it weren't so, but we all do. Now, pruning is an art form as much as a horticultural technique. You can tell that I'm not artsy by looking at the plants I've pruned at the parsonage. It looks like you're killing the plant or the bush or whatever you're pruning. But if pruning is done right, then the plant always comes back stronger. Always. It produces more. It flourishes. It grows beyond where it was cut back. Pruning, I'm told, is essential for certain kinds of plants. Because if they aren't pruned, they'll wither and die. Because they don't have the root system to support all that extra growth that isn't necessary. Or it isn't healthy. Or that distracts from its true function of bearing fruit or flower. Let's step back from the metaphor for a minute and acknowledge that pruning hurts. Cutting away what we've been attached to, no matter how unhealthy it is for us, is hard and painful. And it makes us ask that question that we don't like to admit we ask. Is it worth it? Is it worth the struggle? Pain, the self-denial, to live this life that Jesus offers us, to enjoy this abundance that he wants to pour down upon us? Is the fruit that we bear, this commandment to love God and neighbor with equal amounts of passion and service, is it worth the effort it takes? Next week, we continue our reading from the 15th chapter of John, and Jesus says directly, it's more than worth it, but we must trust him. And the moments of real joy that we have experienced in life are always caught up in loving and being loved. So we know we want more. More of him, more of love, more joy. Stay close. Abide in me is the way he says it. We're learning to abide, to seek those moments when we can be in Christ's presence, when we can soak up that word, we can sing praises and of healing and of loving and reconciling. We want to stay close, but how? Well, that's too big a question for us to answer today. The short answer is another metaphor. We need to be grafted into the vine. Now, there's nothing about grafting in these verses. Vines, abiding, pruning, be cut off, yeah, but not grafting. So we'll just take Jesus' metaphor a little further. Now, grafting is a process whereby one plant, I looked it up, it's called the scion, the offspring, becomes part of another, the rootstock. or in today's example, the vine. This process allows the plants to become one. But the only way for the scion to be grafted into the rootstock is if the rootstock, the vine, is cut, is pierced, to make room to allow entry. By his wounds we are healed. Again, abide in me as I abide in you. Oh, there's a second part. As I abide in you. He's leaving, but he's not leaving. He's with us, even to the end of the age. That means we're with him, come hell or high water. We are with him, and he is with us. We remember the events of Holy Week, that divine drama that is acted out as a historical remembrance year after year, hopefully to our great appreciation. Except that it isn't really a historical remembrance. It's the rhythm of our faith. Christ comes to us, and for joy, we ask him to save us because Christ comes to us. To us, to you. With tears streaming down our faces, we embrace him and hope for a new start, a new opportunity, and a new outlook on life. But after a while, the glow kind of dies down. And this new outlook on life begins to look a lot like the old look. And takes just as much effort to hold on to, if not more. And our disillusionment grows, and we look for someone to blame, a scapegoat who must be at fault for all the rotten things in life that we've been given. We lash out and we cast aside that which only recently so seemed so full of possibility and hope, and now tastes like ashes instead of bread and wine. And we turn our backs on the one we wept over, and we flee in fear and shame and doubt. And in the darkness we feel alone. Like no one understands. Like no one's on our side. Like no one. There's just no one. For us, there's no one. We've moved apart from him and can do nothing. Or nothing that we do seems worth doing. Or nothing that we have done seems to amount to anything anymore. Apart from him, life is empty. The colors are muted. The air is heavy. Gravity seems to pull that much stronger. Apart from him. Instead, we are grafted into the vine, and we receive the strength that we need to bear good fruit. Instead, we abide in him. So be it. Our response to the word begins with sharing our joys and concerns with one another. Rachel, I didn't write it down and I've forgotten. What's your son's first name?
Britton.
Britton, yeah. Britton Webb, keep him in your prayers. He's Still got some health issues that are causing trouble. A lot of people got some new health issues today. Got a message this morning. Some of you may know the name, may know him, Frank Beard. He was a pastor here in the North Conference, served at one time at Walnut Creek on the south side of Warsaw. He's now a bishop, and he's assigned to the Iowa area. But he's a large African-American man, and statistics got to him some time ago. He has glaucoma, and just in the last few weeks, he's lost almost complete sight in his eyes. So, and he's only a year or two older than I am, so early 60s. So he's taking an emergency six-month leave, and he's going to be spending at least 4 months at the Mayo Clinic as they try to save his vision. So keep him in your prayers. Also, if you hadn't heard, Nancy Tiger passed away Friday morning. She was at home, surrounded by her family. Her visitation will be Tuesday afternoon from 4 to 6 at McKee's Mortuary, and the service will follow at 6 p.m. Carolyn Underwood is having major back surgery this Thursday, and so she would appreciate your prayers. All I really understand about it is she'll be coming home with a lot more stuff inside of her than she goes into the hospital with. And so yeah, she's a little apprehensive, so your prayers are welcome. Cards, calls probably help too. Jill Jackson, part of Rita's extended family, mother of two small children, goes into the hospital in Indianapolis this week to have a biopsy of a mass in her throat. So keep her in your prayers as that comes forward. Also, keep my wife Pam in your prayers. A couple of weeks ago, she had a stomach bug, and apparently it's come back. As of last night, she didn't get much sleep, at least not in the bed. I don't know if she fell asleep in the other room or not. Keep her in your prayers and pray that she keeps it to herself. She did last time. Maybe it'll work this time. This week, we're praying for Thursday's child ministry and the director of Ruth Ann Schlitt. So keep that ministry in your prayers this week. The card is in the back if you would care to sign it at the end of the service. Now, is there anything that was shared on Facebook this morning?
No new prayer requests from anyone on Facebook.
Okay. How about here in the congregation? Are there any?
I'd ask for prayers for the family of Rubina Sehar. She passed away actually last Sunday, probably about when we were in church. She's got two sons. The younger son is Emma's age, so at least out of high school. But still, they still need her.
Keep the family of Marvin Blocker. He passed away. I've lost track of the days, but I think Thursday or Friday, of a massive heart attack. And he's a distant relative of ours.
Any others?
I'd ask for prayers for my great niece, Hannah. She's 35 years old. Previously had gone through treatment for cervical cancer and has been cancer-free, but they found cancer in one of her hips now. Got three young children, but anyway, keep Hannah in your prayers, please.
Oh, one more.
I thank the Lord for the season because it's mushroom time and they're out there full. So I can hardly wait to go home for dinner today.
Amen. Any others? I invite you to join me in our prayer of confession. The words will be on the screen. It is responsive. And I invite you to join me when we get to the bold print. Let us pray. We thank you, gracious God, for Jesus Christ, the true vine, with his roots eternally grounded in you. We rejoice that by grace we have been grafted into him, to be branches on a vine that bears the loveliest of all the fruits of earth. Yet we confess that all is not well with the way we live. Please forgive us for the occasions when we have been the ones to introduce disease into the vine, preferring contamination to the vigor of health. Forgive us for neglecting to draw deeply on the sap of life, for our tendency to wander instead of growing on the framework you provide, for being content and sometimes even proud of a few sparse or undersized fruits, for the apathy which lets us go through some seasons without bearing any fruit. Have mercy on us. Please do not lose patience or sever us completely from the true vine. Rather, heal our diseases. Discipline and train our wandering tendrils. Prune our unfruitful branches and cut away our diseased ones. May we remain in Christ and he in us through all the changing seasons of life. Let us delight in bearing the fruits of love that are our true purpose and joy. For your name's sake, amen. Hear these words of assurance. Jesus said, I will reside in you. If you reside in me and my words reside in you, ask whatever you will and it shall be done for you. Friends, we have asked for forgiveness and correction. It has been truly done for us. It is being done for us. And it will be done for us. Amen. We turn now in our worship to our time of tithes and offerings. Someday we'll pass a plate again, but in the meantime, for those of you that are here, there's an offering plate at the back. You can drop your offering off on your way out. For those of you watching online, the mail works wonderfully. Or if you drop by during office hours, you can drop off your gift to the church. We give thanks for all that you give because that enables us to be in and to do the ministry God calls us to do. Our offertory sentence this morning comes from the 22nd Psalm. I offer praise in the great congregation because of you. I will fulfill my promises in the presence of those who honor God. Let us consider these words as we hear the offertory. may be seated. Well, that night in which Jesus talked with his disciples about leaving, they had shared a supper. He told them, but they didn't get it, that it would be the last time that they were together for a while. And then, when he did come from the grave alive, they were afraid and scared as if they had never heard it before. And on that night with them, he took bread, he broke it, and he gave it to them and said, "Take, eat, this is my body given for you." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, and after giving thanks, he passed it, and he said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood given as the new covenant for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." And so we come this day as a holy and living sacrifice to give of ourselves, that the love of God might flow through us, that we might produce the fruit of love. In a hurting and hungry world. Today, for the last time, I hope, we use what I've now found are called COVID cups. Two seals on top. The top seal is clear plastic with, most of them we have two different boxes we have, but most of these have a little wheat head printed on them. You'll peel that one back to reveal the wafer, and then peel the bottom aluminum seal to reveal the juice. Ask the ushers to come forward at this point. They will serve you.
Join us.
bread which we share is a sharing of the body of Christ. The cup over which we give thanks is a sharing in the blood of Christ. Let us pray. Lord, we give thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. May we abide in you and allow you to abide in us so that you may live in this world. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please stand as we sing our hymn of invitation, How Can We Name a Love? The words will be on the screen.
We can call and mine.
please join me in our blessing. Go now and love one another, because love is from God.
Proclaim God's salvation to every generation. Remain in Jesus Christ, and like branches on the vine, draw your life from him.
And may God, the vine grower, tend you and make you fruitful. May Christ Jesus abide in you and give you life. And may the Holy Spirit cast out all fear and fill you with God's love.
We join in peace to love and serve God in the name of Christ.
And we go knowing that we are connected to our source of strength. As we allow Christ to abide in us and we in him, all to the glory of God's kingdom. Go in peace. Amen.
Down with